I'm so used to just downloading the episodes into my brain now, thanks to future technology, but alas, it's no longer at my disposal. Now I'm gonna have to do it the old-fashioned way that everyone's used to, just the primitive way of watching it and then remembering it. Ugh, it's so much hard work. I don't want it. Why do I have to do that when I could just download it in my brain? Oh, that's right, the batteries died in. Types of batteries don't exist in this time period.
God damn it!
Well, I'm gonna have to do it the old-fashioned way. Why am I saying this as if I haven't done it already, even though I just did? Because how else would I be able to release this week's episode of the Super Villain Vlogs? That was a really rocky one. Okay, alright, back on the saddle. Yes, as clarified last week, I am going to keep doing the Super Villain Vlogs, despite whatever anyone tells me, even Zoom. Screw Zoom. Oh, I will prevent the apocalypse in a different way. I just haven't figured that out yet. I mean, I know preventing the apocalypse should be a number one type priority. However, on the other hand, however, you know what? I do believe that getting used to doing this show again should be given a little bit more consideration. You know, first I'll get used to doing this show again. You know, even though I just did this for the past couple of weeks already. No, I need more time to get used to doing it again. Then I'll figure out how I'm going to prevent the apocalypse. Okay, all right. Okay, let's get back on the saddle now, and we will start with Supergirl. Yes, discussing the supervillainy of TV shows, starting with that one. And we get a villain that we've been hyping up for a very long time on Supergirl, ever since a few episodes ago. And unlike Gorilla Grodd, and thankfully they did not stretch her out for several friggin' episodes, just so we can be disappointed by her barely being an episode. No, they prevented as much disappointment by having less episodes to hype her up. So we finally get Bizarro Supergirl, and it was very interesting going into this one. Going into the concept of using Bizarro Supergirl, because it brings up the question of, wait a minute, if we got Bizarro Supergirl here, does that mean that Bizarro Superman already exists? And apparently what they decided to do was prevent any complications of being like, there was a Superman clone that was called Bizarro, and now here's a Supergirl clone called Bizarro Girl, or whatnot. And that's what happened. Nope, they decided to forego all that. They decided, no, that would be too complicated for us. We're not gonna do that. We're not gonna go that route and pre-establish a Bizarro Superman, okay? I mean, we're already not bothering showing Superman himself. I mean, they could have just said that there was this Bizarro Superman and just, let him not ever be on the show, because that's what they're doing with the real Superman, is they're like, oh yeah, we acknowledge his existence, but fuck you, we're never gonna show him. So you would think that's how they would tackle that, but no, instead they decided that it would make the episode a lot more easier to do if they just took the Bizarro concept and made it new for this show instead of something that pre-existed. It's actually a new concept. It turns out there was never a Bizarro Superman in this continuity. There is only a Bizarro Supergirl, which is why in the episode she's not even called Bizarro Supergirl, because there's never been a Bizarro Superman. Therefore, she's simply just Bizarro, just like how Bizarro Superman is usually just called Bizarro. I always thought, well, isn't it weird how Bizarro Superman is just simply called Bizarro, whereas Bizarro Supergirl has to be called Bizarro Supergirl? Well, what's going on there? But nope, they decided, you know what, fuck it, well, we're just gonna have Bizarro Supergirl be on the show, and she will be the only Bizarro. It'll be like the previous Bizarro never freaking existed. But then again, they did that all the friggin' time on Arrow. I mean, they had fucking Ra's al Ghul be the main villain of season 3, and not once did he ever even mention his connection to Batman. Yes, they took an arch nemesis, or one of the arch enemies of Batman, and made him an Arrow villain, and just pretended that he was always that. Exclusively. So if Arrow can do it, then yeah, sure, why not? It's fair. But hopefully they won't do that with all the Superman villains. I mean, it's weird how so far the only Superman villain that has shown up here that actually is acknowledged as a previous Superman villain is the one who wasn't even necessarily a Superman villain in the comic books, and that's Reactron. He is given this whole backstory about his arrival of Superman in the series, but in the comic books, he's more of a Supergirl villain. So that he could have been the one who was exclusively a Supergirl villain, but no, instead they're doing that with everyone else. Livewire, Toy Man, as far as I know regarding Toy Man, but yes, and we're about to do the Black Death next week, or whatever the hell that character's name is called, Black Nightmare or something. The dark bestial weed thing. You know what I'm talking about? That Audrey 2 looking root thing that's known for giving Superman a drug trip. Yes, and it's gonna be interesting to see what happens there too. Are they gonna pretend that the Black Death thing never possessed Superman either? It's only possessing Supergirl, and that's it. It never latched on to old Superman. Are they gonna do that like how they're doing with the Bizarro concept in this episode? I mean, if they do, then that's when I'm gonna get a little iffy on this. That's when I'm gonna call foul a little bit and be like, hey, wait a minute. You don't have to make everything exclusively Supergirl. You know, some of the things you can pre-establish, like this one, especially since it's such an iconic Superman comic, you know, at least acknowledge that it happened to him first and then her. But who knows? By the time you hear this episode, you probably already know that because I usually post these after the next week Supergirl airs. But then again, maybe not. Maybe you'll hear this right before, or you're never gonna freaking see this. The last possibility is probably the most true, isn't it? Okay. But you know what? If we are never gonna see Bizarro Superman, which is probably likely because we'll never see Superman, then that's fine. Because you know what? Bizarro Supergirl is a fine substitute. Because that still means we get to see the concept of Bizarro established in live action. And don't give me this always done in Smallville bullshit. Fuck you! I don't regard Smallville as hardly anything, okay? And plus, I heard he was just like an alternate personality in that. No, I want a real Bizarro, and that's what we get here. A clone that was meant to be an identical duplicate of Kara that eventually transformed and it decayed and it showed itself as it really is, a horrible abomination monster copy of Supergirl, complete with the caveman talking, "Me am Tarzan, you am Martian Manhunter." Yes, that's the classic Bizarro. Yes, we finally get to see Bizarro used, because he probably never fucking will in the movies. So that's fine using him here, whatever. Even if it is as Bizarro Supergirl, because you know what? There is a Bizarro Supergirl in the comic book, so it's fine to use that version here too. It's just that she's gonna have to be in place of Bizarro Superman. Yes. So wait a minute. You mean to tell me that no one ever thought of cloning Superman? They just immediately thought of cloning Supergirl? and notice that they did not kill off Bizarro. Yes, they did not. Instead, they decided to put her under sedation. They put her on drugs right before Kara's about to go on her own drug trip. Yes, they put her out, and they're gonna put her, like, in some kind of room and have her go nappy-nappy by until the show needs her again to do some stuff. Yes! So something tells me that this is going to be a recurring villain, Bizarro Girl. Who knows? Maybe she'll become even more like her comic book counterpart. Although she kind of already is, I mean, to the point where she was mutilated in the face enough to be played by a different actress. So, yeah, that's probably as Bizarro Girl as they're gonna get. You know, at least, like, I don't know, like, maybe make the costume a little bit more purpley, like the comic book counterpart, you know, and maybe give her that, cardboard S thing, and just suggestions, really, just some suggestions. Okay, now let's move on now. I think we talked enough about that. Let's move on over to, the next episode of the week to discuss, and that is, yes, more estrogen for the win. Peggy Carter, yes, yes. I wonder if how many people I'm gonna offend by always using that as a segue between Supergirl and Peggy Carter. Just saying estrogen. Maybe I'll change it up. Maybe I'll say instead, here's the next heroic lady who wears blue and red. No, I'm just gonna say estrogen. Okay, let's discuss once again, Madam Mask. Okay, and I want to get this, I want to clear some things up. I really like this version of Whitney Frost. It's really growing on me, this version. Slowly I'm beginning to accept that, you know, maybe this is, gonna be our only interpretation of this character, because I was thinking, like, you know what, since they don't use her actual name, because she has, like, a fake name in this, like, Abigail something, or not fake in regards to the show, and in the show that's her real name, and Whitney Frost is a stage name, but since they used a made-up name to be her real name, you know, made up for the show, I mean, maybe that means that they're saving the actual Madam Mask for something else in the present. However, if this is the only interpretation we'll ever see in the MCU, then I'm fine with that. Because they're making her slowly more and more like that counterpart. Especially with the fact that she's got a super duper tragic backstory, and it all has to do about her face. Yes, that's all Madam Mask, pretty much. I mean the details are changed, of course, but it's the same basic outline of that character, the same basic, makeup of that character. Oh, get it? Makeup, because she has a horrible scar, ba-dum-ching. It's, and this scar is slowly getting bigger and bigger, slowly causing, or it appears to be causing her face to rip off, to decay away. And if it does, that means she'll have no choice but to wear a mask. Yes, and it's probably gonna be given by her husband. Yes, who she owns the balls of. Yes, she has her husband's balls. She puts it in her purse so that she doesn't lose them, because he'll probably lose them because he no longer has a sack to put those balls in. Yes, and the reason why he no longer has balls is because she basically owns his ass now, because he has witnessed her glorious super villainy. Yes, he has witnessed it her firsthand now. Before, she had to keep her super powers on the down low, you know, being able to take Sclair Brothers and send them to the possible negative zone, I'm not sure, but being able to take people and make them bleed out Venom Goo, that probably is not Venom Goo, but that's not going to stop everyone on the internet speculating that it's Venom Goo, even though it clearly isn't. And sucking them up inside of her somehow. Yes, along with all those rats. So imagine somewhere right now, one of the Sclair Brothers is floating in a black void with a bunch of squeaking mice. Hey, mice, you're my only friends now. Let's throw a mice party. Yes. Oh, but he does have another. He has another guy at the party. This henchman who Peggy Carter broke the hand of. He's there too. Just don't expect him to be the DJ of the party because, you know, broken hand, and also it's the 1940s. Yes. So now, Whitney Frost's husband is aware of this, and now he must become her henchman. Yes, he now knows his place in this show, that he is destined to be only a mere henchman of the real villain. Before, he thought he was the main villain of the show. He was like, "Oh, I'm totally the big bad of Agent Carter season two. Yeah, that's totally my role." But nope, the blanket has been swept from under him, from under his feet, and he is no longer the big bad of the season. In fact, he never really was, but now he's aware of it. Now he knows what's really going on. She's the big bad, and he's gonna have to answer to her now. Yes, he's inevitably gonna die. I know it. I can see him being crushed, imploded by that venom goo right now. I can see that in my mind. Yes, I am calling that character's fate. But at least give her a nice present before you do that. You know, since you clearly are living on borrowed time, you know, give her a nice golden mask. You know, treat your wife before she inevitably kills you. Give her a nice golden mask, and then you can die. Okay. Yes. But that's not the only stuff we got regarding Madam Mask, because you know, as I said before, now, this is not something that I noticed at first, but I did slowly, is that not only was I noticing the difference between this version and the comic version, which I'm okay with now, which I'm perfectly fine with now, but there was something else that was beginning to rear its ugly head, and that was the fact that, is she your only villain? I mean, it's been a while since we got some other antagonists here up in this show. I mean, I know we had that guy with the cold that disintegrated into a bunch of little ice pieces, but surely there's other people here, and surely there's other people here, and I know we've also got that secret empire going on, but they barely do shit. She's been the only one doing shit here. But you know what? I'm slowly becoming fine with that too. I know we're getting the Maja eventually in this season, but before that, I don't mind if we take this time to have her as the only villain. That means more of an opportunity to flesh her out with a backstory. Yes, we get her origin story that mirrors with Peggy's story, and as that happens, I'm like, hey, screw you, Peggy, go away, put. Take your origin story out of my face. I'm more interested in Whitney Frost's origin story, thank you very much. And I keep trying to move Peggy's origin story out of my face so I can pay more attention to because it's getting in the way of Whitney Frost's origin story. How she was an average, mild-mannered farm boy. Farm girl, complete with a hillbilly accent, And she was old, and she taught herself because her mother was a hussy who kept getting screwed all the time. Oh my God, she has the same exact backstory as Forrest Gump. Oh God, it's exactly the same. Oh my gosh. The difference is that she doesn't have a mental disability, which means that if Forrest Gump did not have a mental disability, that would have meant that he would have became a mastermind supervillain that would have controlled us all. However, it would have been nice with his world domination, because he would have made everyone eat chocolate every day and run on shit and play ping pong and collect bird feathers. And that would have been perfectly okay, fine, whatever. So anyway, well, I went way off topic with that one. But anyway, no, I am gonna call bull a little bit in the fact that really your mother was so hot-headed, was such an uncaring person that she didn't give a shit that you were a friggin' mastermind genius? Are you kidding? What kind of person just nods that off? I mean, sure, the Homer Simpson teacher from Fantastic Four, the reboot, he probably would have done that too, yeah. He probably would have, he probably would have just hoofed that off too. But seriously, anyone else would have been like, holy fuck, my little child is a freaking mastermind genius. Oh my god, I'm gonna make so much money off this child. I love this child. This is the best child ever. I wouldn't be like, oh, look at you trying to be all intelligent and fixing radios and making blueprints for friggin' particle accelerators and finding the cure of cancer. Oh, you think you're so important. Well, guess what? I'm having sex with people, with a bunch of people. So screw you, little child. Screw you for being smarter than me. What the fuck? I mean, granted, I'm sure there's those types of parents out there. They probably exist. But still, it's like, most people would be freaking, like, excited as hell. Like, oh my god, I can finally get out of this piece of dump farm and be rich because my child is the freaking, has a higher IQ than goddamn Albert Einstein. Oh my god, why am I not taking advantage of this? Why am I just making her feel like shit? Making her feel like shit. Oh, that's right, because she has to become an actress instead. Yes, this makes all the difference, because if she didn't have that horrible, abusive lifestyle, then she would have never been an actress and instead just went straight to the science field, yes, and would have only been a scientist. And who knows, if she was only a scientist instead of an actress, then maybe she wouldn't even be a supervillain. She'd just be a scientist who produced the cure for cancer and whatnot and all this amazing stuff, and we would probably get flying cars by now instead of Bulbkiss right now, although we do have a few in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., whatever. However, by her being both an actress and a scientist, that's a deadly combination, isn't it? And that is what created the glorious supervillain we have before us today. Also, the superpowers is a big plus two in that involvement. But anyway, alright, moving on, I mean, But I do want to clarify before I do that I still want to see other potential villains here. Okay, you can't just do the same villain over and over again. We need others. We need, if you want a big bad, then fine, sure, go with her. But guess what? The point of a big bad is to be the main antagonist, main, which implies that there's others who are not as main. So show us those friggin' others already. Okay. Let's move on now over to the Flash. Yes, now, the main villain of this episode in particular will not be discussed, because he will recap his own accounts by person in the studio. But he's going to need a little bit of assistance, and I put together a little bit of a meeting between him and some other dimensional beings right now. Yes. Now, before, I could not do that. I could not set up such a meeting. But now that I have these trusty old vortexes, these trusty old portals that send people to other dimensions and universes, I can make that happen now. It's so great. Thank you, Satan. Thank you, Lucifer. If you're confused as fuck as what I just said, then watch the previous episode, okay? Okay. Alright, now I just have to figure out which one of these portals is the one that goes through time, and which one is the one that goes through space. I think it's the green one. I think the green one is the one that, goes through space. Okay, send that one over to the special guest's room, okay? Alright. Okay, now that I've got that settled, let's move on. Wait a minute! Before I move on, I forgot one final thing. Dr. Wells has been found out! Yes! The whistle has been blown! Who was this freaking bastard who did that? Who blew the whistle and tattletailed on Dr. Wells that he was in cahoots with Zoom? Oh, it was himself. You stupid dumbass! Well, why would you do that? Oh, just because you're guilt. Oh, I get it. Because of out of guilt. The guilt trip. You were guilt tripped by Flash and Vibe. I can't believe you caved in. You deserve to be put on timeout by Joe. You deserve that. How could you do that. You don't deserve to be taken out of that prison. Oh, wait, you were. Oh, and you're going to the Earth 2. Finally! God damn! Ugh, this Earth 2 has been hyped up as being such a more interesting universe than this one that I'm like, when the fuck are we gonna freaking go there? Now, that doesn't mean I don't want to see other universes being explored, because I realize, you know, we are just about halfway done through this season, or we might already be, but we're halfway through the season, and I don't think we've been really exploring all of those 52 universes. In fact, I think we're only exploring Earth 2, and that's it. Like, why establish that there are portals to 52 universes when you only go to one of them, and we only see the effects of one of them here? Like, show us some goddamn others! But alas, we're gonna have to wait a while. You know, that Flash Supergirl crossover's coming up soon, and that's probably what that's gonna be all about. So don't worry, it's coming. It is coming. Okay, so let's, now we can move on. Now we can move on to Arrow. Yes. Oh, yes, the show that is becoming so forgettable the more I talk about it, to the point where I don't know what the fuck happened this episode. Let me try to friggin' think for a moment. Oh, yes, now I'm beginning to remember. Oh, yes, the calculator. Yes, we finally got the calculator. Yes, now this is a character that's been screaming to get an adaptation on the Arrow. You know, he's a more grounded villain. He does not require superpowers. They could have done this character, like, back when the show was trying to be all grounded and didn't allow superpowers. You know, but then they became more progressive and became more accepting of superpowers. Good for them. Good for them for being progressive. And now, even though they are willing to show more outlandish type supervillains, they still care for the little guy. They still care for the non-superpowered villains, such as the Calculator. Yes, the Calculator. This is a character that I've been speculating for a long time that would be a perfect opportunity to do on this show, back when the show was good. But nonetheless, you know, that doesn't mean they still can't use him. You know, that's fine. They didn't get their Calculator license revoked. They can still use him. And what's great is that now he can be redeemed from his Brave and the Bold interpretation, because in that he's just a man-child who's like an internet troll who, like, lives with his parents in a basement, and his costume includes, like, his underpants. He doesn't even wear pants. But I am glad to confirm that this version of Calculator does in fact wear pants, and he's the father of Felicity Smoke. Well, he just got 2 points off. Why are you connected to her? Oh, so you're to blame. You're to blame for the reason why I have to deal with the bullshit that comes out of Felicity Smoke's mouth every goddamn episode. How could you do this to us, Calculator? You're supposed to be... Wait just a minute. 1 minute. Wait a minute. This actually makes sense that he would be her father. In fact, I even called this. I'm not sure if I ever mentioned this in the previous season of the Supervillain Vlogs, but I have speculated for the longest time that the Calculator probably is Felicity Smoke's dad. Like, I kind of predicted that back in season 3, and maybe even earlier than that, because, you know, he's basically the male, he's basically Felicity Smoke if Felicity Smoke was an old man, basically. That's basically what the Calculator is. You know, they're both good at they're good as fuck as hacking, and they're both always in front of a computer screen, and they're basically cyber terrorists, basically. I mean, I think Smoke used to be, but then again, given the moral fogginess with a lot of the characters on Arrow, she might as well be. She probably is a cyber terrorist, probably, given with all the rules they break on this show. So she probably is. So yeah, so it probably makes too much sense not for them to be connected in some way. In fact, I remember in an early season 3 episode last year, I remember there was an episode that explored her backstory and how she had a hacker partner that turned out to be this horrible criminal mastermind. And I remember back then, I speculated, wait a minute, is that the calculator? Did they make calculator Felicity's ex? And the answer is no. Instead, they made the calculator Felicity's dad instead. So they did a different connection to Felicity for the calculator, a different one. And I think that was inevitable. He was inevitably going to be connected to Felicity in some way, somehow. And that's fine. You know, whatever. I'll do it that way. It's a lot better than having her being possessed by a ghost of gothic past. That was friggin' stupid. Yeah, fine. Do it this way. Do a Darth Vader type thing. Whatever. Fine, whatever. As long as we get the calculator. And as long as he continues to be an evil version of Mr. Rogers, apparently. It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. It's a beautiful day to get your ass hacked and blow up the internet. Wait a minute. Does he work for Damian Dark or does he work for Donald Trump? We gotta get rid of the internet. There's too much internet. We gotta break it down. I'm gonna get a hammer and I'm gonna go to the internet and I'm gonna hit in the balls. I'm Donald Trump. I'm gonna use my hair to get rid of the internet. And that was my input on this week's debate. Okay, let's move on now from Arrow to the Legends of Tomorrow. Yes, where I continue my watch. I continue to observe and monitor over Leonard Snart and Mick Rory. Yes, I must continue to be vigilant over them. Yes, I'm trusting them. I'm trusting them to keep their super villainy throughout this season. I'm trusting them to keep their villainy and not cave in. Don't let this experience through the timeline make you rethink your ways. Don't let it turn you into a superhero, okay? Okay, Captain Cold, I'm fine with you, Heatwave. You're probably just gonna stay whatever. But you, Captain Cold, I have to keep extra eyes on. I have to make sure that you keep being a supervillain, okay? And I have to watch over you. And it seems very evident that maybe you won't change. Because at first, Captain Cold tried to do something good in this episode. And at first, I'm like, hey, what are you doing, Captain Cold? I mean, it was weird. It was like a roller coaster in this episode. First he did something bad, but then it appeared to be to do something good, but then it turned out to blow up in his face, and maybe that means he'll stay villainous. Yes, it was a roller coaster this episode, because first he peer pressured Jay Jackson into helping him steal a precious diamond or whatever the fuck that was. Was it kryptonite? It looked like kryptonite. Oh, that's how they tie this into Supergirl, I guess. Kryptonite. Yes, whatever the fuck that was, it looks like kryptonite, so fuck it, I'll call it kryptonite. First he peer pressures Jay Jackson into helping him steal kryptonite from this museum, and at first I'm like, yes, he is retaining his super villainous lifestyle, yes, finally, yes, because he's using this opportunity in the 70s to steal shit, yes, he is still an evil supervillain. But then it turns out he did that apparently for good because he gave it to his father. Yes, he gave it to his past father. And since this is in the 1970s, that means that his father has not turned into Ironside yet. No, he's too young. No, instead he's some guy. So he gives his father, who's played by some guy now, the diamond or kryptonite or whatever that is, in the hopes that his father will never lay a hand on Leonard or his little sister or his mother or Mama Snart, which is good for you. Good for you, preventing. Good for you for preventing family abuse, for preventing spouse and child abuse. Good for you, Captain Cold. I mean, at first I was like, wait a minute, that's not super villainous, but then I thought, oh, wait a minute, that's being a good person. Okay, fine, whatever, that's okay. I mean, now I should reprimand him for doing something that was not super villainous, necessarily, but keep in mind that he risked changing the timeline. So that was sort of being super villainous. I mean, maybe it was more of being reckless, which isn't necessarily a moral thing, but still, it's something that could fuck stuff up, so that was fine. And Post, it's the same as Sister. I mean, I remember earlier this season on The Flash, I freaked out about this. Like, oh, that's too real, man. Oh, I'm good. And now he has a chance to make sure that never happens. And he's such a great brother. Oh, God, he's such a good brother. He even decides not to kill his father right there, because that would prevent the existence of the Golden Glider. And Vibe would be all sad. But he'd already be sad because instead he got stood up by Hawk Girl, who is currently fighting her own supervillain, Parts of a Knife. Yes, that's the other supervillain this episode. So the Atom has to do a fantastic voyage to deal with that shit, and he has to have a story arc with Professor Stein. Is this how every episode is going to be? Like, is this the formula where every episode we have to have a subplot where the Atom has to deal with their differences between a fellow member and get along? If you're going to do that, then, you know, switch it up sometimes, you know. Although now I think that they probably are going to make that the formula, where each episode a particular duo, a particular matchup of two different characters have to sort their differences and be buddies. Oh God, that's gonna get repetitive as fuck. Oh, I don't want to think about this anymore. I want to think about some good old-fashioned villainy instead. Oh, here's some good old-fashioned villainy. Not only is Vandal Savage back, but so are his followers. Yes, he's got followers. He's got followers, and they're all culty and stuff. They're more badass of a type cult than the ones that were in Heroes Reborn. Yeah, those were like the pansy type of, like the G-rated type of cult members. They were like a G-rated type cult in Heroes Reborn. But this is a full-on R type cult. I was about to make an Eyes Wide Shut reference, but then Mick Rory beat me to it. God damn it, Heatwave. But yes, that means Heatwave and Captain Cold had to do the heroic thing and help them with that situation and get them free. Man, I wanted them to drink the holy blood of Hawkman, you know? You know, Jesus has had that treatment too many times. No, Hawkman deserves it at least once, okay? Okay, Jesus, can you do that for Hawkman? Can you do that? But no, instead they bury Hawkman along with the corpse of their son. Finally concluding the story arc as to what was going to happen to that corpse of the Hawk's son and Hawkman's dead-ass body. Let's get back to Captain Cold and Heatwave for a moment. Yes, as I said before, Captain Cold tries to do something noble, you know, prevent his sister and his mother and himself from having an abusive-ass father, because the reason why he was abusive was because he had his ass in jail, and it hardened that asshole even more than it already did, all because he got caught trying to steal that kryptonite. Or at least I call it kryptonite. And he believes by instead just giving it to him, preventing him from being caught, that means that he won't, all that bullshit will not happen. Well, guess what? It happens anyway. Yes, time has a thing about healing about itself, you know, about keeping things going. Or at least it does in this particular episode. It probably won't in another one because, you know, fuck time travel, am I right, writers? You just have time travel serve whatever you want it to friggin' do. So if you want it to screw, if you want it to screw Captain Cold in the ass, then you're gonna make it. Yeah. So that's what happens. He still goes to jail, inevitably. Captain Cold's papa. He still goes there, and he still is destined to transform into Ironside. It still happens. But you know what? Maybe this means that it's the universe telling you something, Captain Cold. Maybe it's telling you that there is no use in trying to reform your life and doing good. You must stay a villain. You must do that. Think about your fans. Think about that boy who has the Captain Cold action figure. He got that action figure because he wanted a badass supervillain. Think about the children. Yes. So that was the villainy in the episode of in this episode of Legends of Tomorrow. By the way, apparently when his followers drinketh the blood, that means they also get immortal, just like Vandal Savage. We could be immortals, 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 immortals. But wait a minute, wait just 1 minute, wait a minute, one of them died, that means all that blood went to waste, oh boy, but we didn't see him, and that ratty guy, that skinny wormy dude, we didn't see him die, so maybe that means we will see him in a later episode, who knows, oh. Or maybe he died and I wasn't paying attention. I don't know. It could be either one. Okay, now let's move on. Now there's something I must address. I know in the past I've tried to rank the villains, but then I realized, wait a minute, that makes the show more, a lot longer than it would be if I just stopped doing that. So, screw it. I'm not going to do that anymore. But you know what? Let's take a moment to remember all the good times we had ranking the villains and talking about the most badass and least badass. Maybe it will return if I try to get the show under a time limit. But anyway, so that was this week's episode. I hope you don't mind our new title art. We use that for technical purposes. And I hope you don't mind these big-ass portals to other universes and time periods. This is what I'm going to use to contact people from all over existence. From this universe, or this time period, or that universe, or that time period. We're going to get a whole lot of contact from people regardless of whether or not they accept that contact. And isn't that what we all want in life? Alright, I will see you guys next week. On the Super Villain Vlogs. Wait a minute, I don't usually do that. I don't, recite the title at the end. Screw it, I did it anyway. I probably won't remember to do it next week anyway, so you don't have to worry about that.